Okay, so in this last lecture, I want to talk about some rather general considerations regarding the possibility that some currently unknown theory, which is different from quantum mechanics, is going to come in at some level between the level at which quantum mechanics is rather well confirmed experimentally, presumably the level of the certainly the level of the electron and the atom, arguably today, the level of small macroscopic systems, and our own the level of our own everyday consciousness. So the question is, can one do an experimental test of this hypothesis? So what one would like to do is to devise an experimental setup where the naive, at least a naive quantum mechanical calculation, predicts quantum interference of macroscopically distinct states. Now, we do have, of course, it's at some point to discuss what exactly we mean by macroscopically distinct. I said a little about that last time. I'll come back to that later. But I suppose we do have an agreed definition of what states are macroscopically distinct. Next thing you'd like to do is to derive constraints which have to be satisfied by some reasonably defined class of macrorealistic theories and which naive quantum mechanical predictions are going to violate. And then, finally, we'd like to do an experiment to discriminate between the predictions of quantum mechanics and those of the class of macrorealistic theories. I think one can see right away a general pattern which one would like to exploit, as it were. Suppose that we have some system which indeed has available to it two macroscopically distinct states, which I've labeled as plus or minus. For example, in the state, in the case of a squid ring, as I discussed last time, they might be the clockwise and counterclockwise circulating states of something like a billion electrons. A general scheme we might try to follow is to start the system from some one of the two states, say, at some initial time, wait for it to get to some intermediate time where quantum mechanics predicts that it will neither be in the state plus nor minus, but rather in a quantum superposition of the two. Then finally, look for its state at some final time. If we believe that at the intermediate time it really was definitely in one state or the other, and we've done some previous experiments on transition probabilities and so forth, then it would be natural to conclude that we could go from, since we can go from the plus state to either plus or minus, and we can also go from the minus state to either plus or minus, it would therefore seem rather natural to assume in a macro-realistic theory that in the actual experiment we'll end up with roughly 50% plus and 50% minus. On the other hand, if we've chosen our intermediate time right, we may find that there's a quantum interference effect which says that we never get the minus state at all. Okay? The two amplitudes coming from the intermediate state plus and the intermediate state minus interfere destructively, and so we never get any result there at all. So we might think of trying to build an experiment along those lines. Notice one very important point. These states are, plus and minus, are indeed macroscopically distinct. So any attempt to measure directly at the intermediate time whether we have a superposition or a classical mixture of those two states is bound to fail because it would involve us doing order n tomography, and n here is something of the order of 10 to the 9, whatever. So we don't do that. We're lazy and let nature do the work for us. Nature has at her disposal an operator, which we don't, namely the time evolution operator, and that is an exponential of the Hamiltonian. That contains essentially n particle operators in it. So in effect, we're letting nature do an order n tomography for us here. However, so that's a sort of general qualitative idea, but we'd like to be a little more quantitative than that. And to do that, and to oppose specific predictions of quantum mechanics and macro-realism, we, first of all, we need to specify a class, the class of macro-realistic theories. Now we can, you can think perhaps of different ways of doing this, but this is the way that Anupam Garg and I did it in our original 1985 paper, and most discussion has centered on that. First of all, we can take it as an experimental fact that whenever we actually examine the system to see which of the two states is realized, we always indeed find one or other to be realized. That's certainly the case with the squid rings. Those experiments were done quite some time ago now. Whenever you, if you put in this situation where the crudely speaking to a first approximation, the ground state is twofold degenerate, corresponding to clockwise or anticlockwise, and you make a measurement, you always find one or the other. Essentially never find it in some kind of intermediate state. So now the first, our first assumption would be macro-realism per se. That is the assumption that on each experimental run, for any given time t, the quantity q of t, which corresponds to the plus or minus here, plus 1 or minus 1, takes a definite value, either plus 1 or minus 1, whether or not we're actually making an observation at the time in question. So that's, so the basic definition of macro-realism. There is a rather niggly point here. You have to worry about if these states really are different, you have to give the system, in some sense, time, a non-zero time to make the transition between them. So that means you can't, strictly speaking, say that for 100% of the time it's in one or the other, but you can allow for that, and you can actually limit by a direct experiment the magnitude of these transit times. So that's, I think, a fairly inessential complication. Second point, second assumption which we need to build in, I should say right away, as far as I know at least, there is no way of testing assumption one alone. You have to supplement it with something. And we're going to make a second assumption of non-invasive measurability, that there exist a class of ideal negative result measurements which can determine the value of q of t without affecting the state or its subsequent motion. Now, let me emphasize that is not a quantum mechanical assumption. In quantum mechanics, this, of course, would be complete nonsense, because even if I make a negative result experiment in quantum mechanics, that indeed changes the state vector and does affect the subsequent motion. However, we'll come back to the plausibility or not of non-invasive measurability in a minute. And thirdly, one has to make some kind of postulate of induction. And so I'm going to make the simplest version, as it were, which is that the properties of statistical ensembles are determined exclusively by the initial conditions you set and not by what's going to happen thereafter. It actually turns out that, contrary to the Bell's theorem situation, you can actually replace initial conditions by final conditions here, and the outcome is not affected. But we don't need to do that, so let's just stick with initial conditions at the moment. Okay, well, having defined our class of macro-realistic theories in this way, let's try now to derive what we call temporal Bell inequalities. And what we're going to do is to consider a long series of runs on a single macroscopic system with two macroscopically distinct states starting from the same initial conditions. So this is going to be a time ensemble, not a physical ensemble. Right? Have one system, many, many repeated measurements. I'm going to split our ensemble into three sub-ensembles. For sub-ensemble one, I'm going to measure q at times t1 and t2, and I suppose that the outcomes are q1 and q2, or q of t1 and q of t2. For sub-ensemble two, I'm going to make my measurements at time two and t2 and t3 without a measurement at time t1. And for sub-ensemble three, I measure q at times t1 and t3 without a measurement at the intermediate time, t2. Now, from the data on sub-ensemble one, we can compute the experimentally measured correlation, q1, q2. Okay? So one and two stand for the times. Similarly, the data on the sub-ensembles two and three, we can compute the experimental values, q2, q3, q1, q3. And let's define a quantity which is sum of the first two minus the third, and call that the k. So the experimental value of k is given by the expression there. Now, what does quantum mechanics say about this, these quantities? Well, if I've just got a simple two-state Hamiltonian, okay, just for the moment, suppose I do, a simple two-state Hamiltonian of this form, then quite irrespective of the initial state, so in other words, of the ensemble, the quantum mechanical prediction is simply that the correlation of Q of Ti and Q of Tj is cos of omega Ti minus Tj. Okay, that's very, very straightforward. And as I say, I emphasize that's independent of the state before Ti, because in some sense, by determining Q at Ti, you basically forgotten about whatever may have happened before that. Now, of course, the interesting question here is, what does macrorealism predict? By postulate number one, which is macrorealism per se, on any given run at any particular time, or at the times in question, the quantities Q1, Q2, and Q3 simultaneously exist whether or not we're measuring them. And they take value plus or minus one. So then by simple algebra, rather trivial to show that Q1, Q2 plus Q2, Q3 minus Q1, Q3 cannot exceed one. And therefore, for a single ensemble, the ensemble averages, the sum and difference of the ensemble averages also cannot exceed one. And those who want to minimize the significance of these considerations sometimes like to point out that this was actually derived by Boole in 1862, which is in fact correct. Of course, he wasn't doing quantum mechanics at that time. So by conclusions 2 and 3, provided the measurement is carried out non-invasively, then the statistical properties of the three sub-ensembles are identical. This is a very, very crucial point in the argument. Right? We are assuming that it is possible within a macro-realistic theory to carry out the measurement sufficiently non-invasively that we can identify the statistical properties of our three sub-ensembles. Okay? Now, if that's true, then you rapidly come out with the Bell-like inequality that the macro-realistic prediction is less than or equal to 1. Now, this turns out to be violated, just like the standard Bell and CHSH inequalities. This is violated by the quantum mechanical prediction for suitable choices of the t's. For example, if we take the time intervals both to be pi over 3 omega, we find the quantum mechanical prediction is 3 halves. So, if you believe all this, then an experimental discrimination between quantum mechanics and macrorealism is, in principle, feasible. Well, just a bit of a historical note. We first proposed this in 1985, and for approximately the next 15 years, we got a lot of flak from the. I think it's amusing nowadays that people. People here, people just about everywhere in institutes, in any sense connected with quantum information, simply take it for granted that you're going to be able to do experiments with macroscopic objects like squid rings and so forth, and they just behave nicely according to quantum mechanics. That was not at all obvious in the late 80s or 90s, and we got a lot of objections to this. The first objection was that if you're really talking about any kind of states which are macroscopically distinct, then that's going to involve an action in the technical sense of classical mechanics, which is absolutely huge in units of h-bar. And that then allegedly means that the predictions of quantum mechanics will reduce to those of classical mechanics. Well, actually, that statement isn't even true for a start. You can show that there are that has to be heavily qualified before it has any force. But in any case, it doesn't matter, because what one can do, and what one has done, in fact, is to look for a system where you have some kind of reasonably macroscopic variable controlled by a microscopic energy. And this, for example, is certainly true in the case of squids, because although the states you're comparing are, I think, by most people's reasonable criterion, macroscopically or at least mesoscopically different, the actual dynamics between them is being controlled by the Josephson junction itself, by itself, which is in some sense very microscopic and certainly corresponds to a very microscopic energy. So that objection fails. The next objection we got was that this whole program is totally ridiculous because decoherence is going to kill you, stone dead. Well, that kind of objection was typically based on what might call back of envelope arguments. And one particular argument which was put up a lot in the quantum measurement literature went something like this. If you're talking about a macroscopic body, then automatically you're going to find that its energy levels are incredibly closely spaced. And that means that even the very tiniest effect is going to screw up coherence between them. So people said, you know, even the motion of a single electron on a distant star is going to basically spoil the coherence between macroscopically distinct states. Complete nonsense, that argument. A number of reasons why it's nonsense. First of all, although it's certainly true that in general that macroscopic objects do have very closely spaced energy levels, most of those levels are totally irrelevant to the question of superposition. For example, just to take a more or less trivial example, in the fullerene experiments, the fact that the fullerene molecule has lots and lots of internal degrees of freedom is very largely irrelevant to the existence of diffraction, which has to do primarily with the behavior of the center of mass. Now, as we saw in the last lecture, that's not 100% true, but at least to a zeroth approximation it's true. In the case of a superconducting device, like a squid, say, there are lots of levels around. Most of them are totally irrelevant to the interference of states involving oppositely flowing currents. For example, the phonon degrees of freedom are essentially irrelevant to a zeroth approximation. So are the nuclear spins have a very weak effect, et cetera, et cetera. One rather striking feature, which probably most of you are familiar with, is the following. When you think about doing sophisticated experiments involving macroscopic quantum interference on superconductors, the first thing you obviously have to worry about is the normal electrons. Because after all, remember that not all your electrons are bound into Cooper pairs. At non-zero temperature, there will always be a non-zero number of excited single electrons. And these then, if they're there, they do constitute a very efficient mechanism of decoherence. However, let me ask the following question. Take a 1 cm³ block of niobium. Take it down, as we now can almost routinely, to a temperature of, say, 5 mDK. And I'm going to ask you not what is the fraction of normal electrons, but how many normal electrons are there in that 1 cm³ block? And probably many of you know, the answer is 0. Or more precisely, the average is 10 to the minus n, where it is a large number. Okay? So many of the obvious sources of decoherence can be eliminated. And crudely speaking, I would say that the pre-2000 quantum information literature, if you look back on it, almost invariably grossly overestimated the effects of decoherence. Since 2000, people have become a little more cautious since the experiments now exist. But right up to 1999, people were still insisting that these experiments were totally ridiculous. Difficult to remember that now. A final objection, I think, which we luckily, at least, have not yet had to meet, has to do in some sense with the asymmetry of the general program. Well, by which I mean the following. Suppose that you set up an experiment along these lines and it comes out in favor of quantum mechanics. Then I think most people would agree that you've pretty definitively killed off macro-realism, at least at the level of that particular experiment. Right? So you'll see that, for example, if the experiment is done with squids, comes out according to, roughly according to the quantum mechanical predictions, then you can say that, well, at least at the level of squids, macro-realism is a dead duck. Okay? What if the opposite happens? Suppose the experiment appears to support macro-realism. Well, unfortunately, then, there are any number of outs for quantum mechanics. There are the most obvious one being that these are complicated, messy, macroscopic objects. You certainly don't know enough about them to write down a Hamiltonian or a Lagrangian in detail. So all the sort of standard things which we're used to doing, I mean, if you're coming, say, from the background of particle physics or atomic physics or cosmology or whatever, you're used to dealing with situations where you think you really know everything about the system you're talking about. You know your exact Lagrangian, you write it down and then just turn the handle, etc. You can't do that here. You know, you've got this, say, this block of niobium metal sitting on a lab bench. You don't even know where what its exact chemical composition is, let alone where the dislocations and impurities exactly are sitting, etc., etc., etc. So the whole idea of writing down a priori microscopic description, at first sight at least, appears to be totally crazy. However, it turns out there is one way of tackling this difficulty, at least to an extent. If you, as I say, if you come from an area like, say, atomic physics or particle physics, what you would tend to do is to start off by writing down a microscopic Hamiltonian. And from there, you follow the green arrow down, and you might derive a set of predictions for the behavior of the system within the framework of quantum mechanics. And then, if you are interested in a particular kind of regime where what we normally call the semi-classical regime, where the predictions of quantum mechanics, crudely speaking, go over into those of classical mechanics, you would make the transition there and try to predict the results of the classical experiments. So that's one possibility, but as I say, that's not really on for our case, because we just don't know enough to write down in minute detail the microscopic Hamiltonian. However, what we might be able to do is the following. We might be able to start off by looking at the classical experiment. That is, an experiment done in a regime where people pretty much agree that you would expect classical mechanics to work. From experiments done in that regime, you just might be able to derive enough properties of the microscopic Hamiltonian to be useful. You might then be able to go from that microscopic Hamiltonian, a very generic one usually, to make predictions of the quantum behavior. And this, surprisingly, this does appear to work, or at least it has worked so far. For example, there's a very beautiful set of experiments on Josephson devices in the mid-80s by John Clark's group at Berkeley, where they actually measured the parameters of their system, circuit parameters, in the semi-classical limit by a direct experiment. They then were able to feed those into a scheme for the microscopic Hamiltonian, and there's enough information there, it turns out, to actually make highly non-trivial predictions about the effect of the various circuit parameters, in particular the dissipated parts of the circuit, in suppressing the quantum tunneling rate. And that did actually come out rather nicely. The prediction was that the bare tunneling rate, we're talking now about the escape of the phase variable in a so-called phase qubit, a Josephson phase qubit. You can calculate the escape rate using a simple WKB approach. And that gets it wrong. It gets it wrong by a factor of 300. You now, following this technique, put in the effects of dissipation by following the scheme, and lo and behold, you get spot on the experimental result. So at least up to now, that seems to have worked. However, there's one very irritating possibility. I think it's very irritating. I hope no one here espouses it. Suppose that we, sometime in the future, experiments of this class are done at a particular level, let's say squids or something higher, and the result appears not to come out according to quantum mechanics, but apparently according to some kind of macro-realistic theory. One possibility is that people will then say, oh, well, you see, it's just a case of, as it were, previously unsuspected decoherence. You've got these extra degrees of freedom, which you never thought of before, but their only function here is to basically entangle the system with themselves, thereby give enough decoherence to explain your results. I mean, frankly, I think that's this has been discussed, in fact, to some extent in the literature, this possibility. And in fact, there are one or two people around who say, I am never going to believe any result which appears to disprove quantum mechanics because of this possibility. I think, frankly, the only solution to that problem is that, by and large, the people who take this point of view are likely to be the older generation. The younger generation, I suspect, will tend to take the results more seriously, and of course, eventually, the older generation will just die off. That'll get rid of that objection.
Well, luckily, the results don't come out like that. Sorry?
So far, they haven't. Yep, that's right. So, as I say, the program is very asymmetrical. If and when funny things start happening, then there are going to be all sorts of loopholes for quantum mechanics to exploit. Okay, let's come back at this point to the question of how far, if at all, we can justify the assumption of non-invasive measurability. Remember that that in principle at least, within a macro-realistic theory, you can do a measurement which will, within that theory, which is guaranteed not to affect the system or its subsequent behavior. Okay? Well, in some sense that has to be a postulate. You can't ever really give 100% justification to it, but there is a way, or at least a partial way around it, which I've briefly mentioned in a paper way back, and very recently, Meisel et al. Have a preprint out, which does this very explicitly. So let's do the following. Let's start the system at some initial time from, let's say, the minus state, and let's choose our intermediate time such that quantum mechanics predicts unambiguously that at that intermediate time the system is definitely in the plus state. And let's check that prediction experimentally on an auxiliary set of runs. Okay, suppose that's right. I mean, if that's not right, then of course we have to go back to the drawing board. Presumably we've done the wrong quantum mechanical calculation or something. But let's assume it's right. Then let's carry out two sets of runs. On the first series, we start in the minus state at time ti. We do nothing until some final time tf, and then we take statistics of the occupation of plus and minus. And tf can basically be anything, it doesn't have to be any special time. But we'll do it for a whole lot of times, actually. In series two, we start again in the minus state at ti. Now, the intermediate time, we're going to conduct a measurement in what is hopefully a non-invasive way, that is, such that physically the measurement apparatus couples to the system only when it's in state minus, not when it's in state plus. So imagine, for example, I have, use a pencil here. Let's see, I have this blackboard duster here. And let me imagine that this is my macroscopic object and these are the two macroscopic states, right? So at time t intermediate, I'm going to shine a flashlight here. Now, if I actually, of course, if I saw the object, then I argue that I might have affected it, so I throw that one away. If I don't see it, then I argue that within the context of a macro-realistic theory, it had to be here. If it were really here, then I could not have affected it by shining my flashlight here. If you now come back and tell me, well, despite the fact that it really was here, nevertheless, by shining your flashlight here, you affected its state or its subsequent motion, then I think you have to question the meaning of saying it was there in the first place. So I think you can do you can certainly try to do the your allegedly non-invasive measurement in that way. Let's see whether at least under these circumstances it really is non-invasive. We can in some sense check this hypothesis, you see, because we can compare the statistics on the second set of runs with the statistics on the first set of runs. If they're the same, then what have we concluded? We've concluded that at least when quantum mechanics says for sure it's in the state class, and moreover, experiment confirms on a subsidiary set of runs that it was indeed in the state class, then the measurement truly is non-invasive. You can then, of course, repeat this whole scheme for a different value of T intermediate when the system is guaranteed to be in the minus state. Just reverse the roles of plus or minus. If you do indeed find there's no difference between the two sets of statistics, then it would seem very unreasonable within the context of a macro-realistic theory to suppose that just because quantum mechanics says it's in a quantum superposition, therefore it must behave completely differently. So that's basically the plausibility argument. I wouldn't say it's not logically rigorous, but it's at least plausible. So having done that subsidiary set of experiments, you now start taking your real data. What you do is, again, you say shine your flashlight here at time t1. You don't, if you see the object in question, you throw that run away because you might have interfered with it. If you don't see it, then you use the postulate of non-invasive measurability, you keep that run, and it's very easy to show that you can get enough data in this way to work out your correlation functions. And that, as I say, Meisel et al. In their recent preprint go through that in complete considerable detail, that argument. Let me just stop for a moment at that point and ask if there are any questions or comments so far. The next thing I want to talk about very briefly is what we mean by macroscopically distinct, but that's a slightly different topic, so I'll just stop for a moment and ask.
I think.
Oh, I mean, I think one has to. No, they're independent, I think. We'll see that there are some connections, hopefully later on in this lecture. But at least at the zeroth level, they are independent. And I think one has to say right away that, in some sense, Bell's result is cleaner in the sense that the concept of Einstein locality is somehow much, much better embedded in the existing framework of physics than is the concept of non-invasive measurability,
right,
which is replacing it.
That's
assuming, you're right, but that's assuming that I'm really talking about a blackboard duster and the two states are geometrically distinct. I mean, in fact, we'll be dealing with a lot of cases where, in particular with the squids, you see, where the two states in question do not correspond to spatial difference.
Right. Mm-hmm. Right. But why does Bell's argument not rule out?
Macroscopic realism? Macro-realism?
Yeah,
macro-realism. Well, how would it do that? We can think of. I'll come in a few minutes, hopefully, to the question of with the intersection of physical reduction postulates and Bell's inequalities. But I mean, I don't see that. For example, in a case like the squid ring, there's a direct application of the literal Bell's theorem. One of the things I think one has to say right away is that almost all, to my knowledge, discussions of traditional discussions of the EPR Bell setup assume that a definite outcome has been realised at the moment that, say, the photon has entered the anode of the photomultiplier or whatever. If you relax that postulate, then things become a lot more complicated. Right? So you can't really, in discussing the original Bell EPR issues, you can't really avoid the question of when does the realization take place. And say, the sort of standard discussions in the literature mostly implicitly assume a particular answer.
So the difference is, with this case, you want to care about post-measurement state.
Well, you want to care about what is a measurement. You know, when does the measurement happen? The only constraints we can put on are that the measurement can't happen too early, because that would screw up the standard predictions of quantum mechanics, which we know and love. It can't happen too late, because we want to be conscious of directly observing certain outcomes. That's a regime of many orders of magnitude in between. Perhaps maybe this will get a little clearer when I come to the last part of the discussion. But let me go on now very briefly to talk about, you know, macroscopically distinct. I think the problem here is that we have some kind of, I think most of us, at least in the year 2011, have got pretty used to the fact that that if we try to apply like common sense notions at the level of single electrons and atoms, things go pretty badly wrong. So reluctantly, we learn to live with that. On the other hand, at least many of us, not all, but many of us, are still pretty worried about Schrödinger's cat. So you want, in some sense, to find a figure of merit which will, in some sense, tell us why we're not so worried about the electron, but we are worried about Schrödinger's cat. In other words, a measure of Schrödinger's cattiness, if you like, of a particular kind of superposition. This has been the subject of a certain amount of discussion in the literature. In the early days, in the 80s, I tended to emphasize this point simply because of this, I think I mentioned this previously, but there was this prejudice around that phenomena like superconductors and lasers already answered the question I was asking. That's not true at all. So one does want to get away from superconductors and lasers and so forth. And in some sense, you want to quantify the idea that, well, when we're talking about, say, it's like the living and dead state of the cat, then it really is rather weird. The quantum predictions really are rather weird, or at least seem much more weird than they are at the atomic level. And we can do this in various ways. I mentioned last time, I think, that I had my own two ingredients, which I would feed into a figure of merit for macroscopic distinctness. They're extensive difference and what I call disconnectivity, which is, crudely speaking, a sort of very crude measure of multiparticle entanglement. Roughly speaking, how many particles are behaving in very different ways in the two branches of the superposition. There's a rather interesting objection, or not an objection exactly, but rather interesting comment on that point, which was made in a preprint by, it's now published, by Korsbach and et al. A couple of years ago. They focus specifically on the case of squids, which are indeed my favorite example right now. And they raise the question, okay, how macroscopically distinct are these two current states? Well, one possible answer, which I've tended to give in the past, is, you have something like somewhere between 10 to the 7 and 10 to the 10 Cooper pairs, which are behaving differently in these two states. In one case, they're circulating clockwise, the other anticlockwise. However, Korsbach and et al. Pointed out that they asked the question, how many single electrons would I have to displace to get from one of those states to the other? That's a quite sensible question. And they made a definition there. They have a quantity, so they had some other name for it, I call it W. W, the number of electrons you have to displace, is, crudely speaking, the sum over k times the expectation value of nk in the plus state minus its value in the minus state. Actually, there should be a modulus sign on that. Otherwise, it doesn't make too much sense, but lift that off. And now here comes the crucial point, you see. If I were talking about distinguishable particles, where I could actually sort of paint them different colors and so forth, then essentially all of them would be behaving differently in these two states. However, the electrons in a metal are fermions, and they're indistinguishable. So most of them are sitting down there in the Fermi Sea. And the current is carried mainly by a few electrons close to the Fermi surface. So now you can work that number out using their definition. And they find that this number W is, even for the most dramatic experiments using squids today, which are the original SUNY Stony Brook experiments of 2000, this number is only of the order of 5,000. They said, well, that's well below what's generally regarded as as macroscopic. Well, fair enough. However, there's a reply to that, which I think is quite amusing. Let's ask the following question. Suppose I take the smallest dust particle, which is visible with the naked eye, good illumination, but no microscopes or whatever, smallest dust particle, and I compare two states of that particle. In one of them, it's just stationary. In the other, it's moving with a velocity which takes it over its own diameter in, say, 1 second. Now, would you agree that those two states should count as macroscopically or at least mesoscopically distinct? How many think no? Okay. I won't ask how many think yes, but anyway, at least you're in doubt, right? So you're not prepared to say that's not macroscopic. At least it's a candidate. Another question is, how macroscopically distinct are those two states by the same criterion? And the answer is quite easy to work out, but there's a subtlety. This number W is essentially, and Korsbach and et al. Make this remark in their paper, it's essentially the total number of microconstituents multiplied by a ratio of velocities. That is, the ratio of the mean velocity difference of the two states to the characteristic velocity of the constituents. In the case of the metal, that would be the Fermi velocity. Okay? That's why, now because this number is so small, that's why they get a small value of W here. But now also, if we take our grain, say to be of lithium fluoride, it's a good band insulator, the total number is something like 4 times 10 to the 15. But the velocity, well, there now because you have to ask how small a grain can you actually see with the naked eye, dot, dot, I consulted my colleague in experimental psychophysics, Francis Wong, on that one, and I've actually been rather conservative. I've taken a value that's about 5 times the best that you can tell me. It's 5 times bigger. And you plug that in, you find that this gives a very small value of W from the electrons. What about the nuclei? That's the tricky point. The nuclei have a much lower characteristic velocity. It's basically the root mean square velocity and the vibrational ground state. Right? If you take that number and compare it with the velocity of the particle there, that gives you a much larger number, and W comes out at least equal to 10 to the 6th, so pretty much way above this number 5,000. However, here comes the subtlety. If you really take the Korsbach argument seriously, you should not be thinking in terms of individual nuclei, but rather individual nucleons. Now, the nucleon velocity within the nucleus is orders of magnitude higher. You stick that in, cuts you right way, way down. W comes out to be much smaller than 5,000, in fact. So, of course, the obvious response is, well, you cheated. You know, if you've got a complex, a bound complex, then you should treat that as a single unit, treat that, the velocity of that, as the characteristic velocity. Fine. Now go back to the Korsbach example. In the conductor, your electrons are not free. They're bound into Cooper pairs. So you should be talking about the behavior of the Cooper pairs to get you back to your original 10 to the 7 or whatever. So what's very interesting is that whichever way around you run this argument, whether you, as it were, cheat or don't cheat, but if you do it consistently in the two cases, you find that the squids are actually more macroscopic than this dust particle. It's, I think, quite surprising and quite remarkable. Okay. Well, you might ask, what is the experimental situation here? And I think the answer is, well, first of all, there's no experiment, to my knowledge to date, of this along these lines, which looks at the superposition of what you could reasonably call macroscopically distinct states. There are some rather nice experiments, I mentioned these earlier in an earlier lecture, by the Oxford group, which I think are still not published, which basically do this kind of experiment for microscopic objects, nuclear spins, in fact. And not surprisingly, come out with the conclusion that, in this case, not macrorealism, but realism doesn't work. That's not terribly unexpected. There's one experiment which does claim, tentatively claim, to be dealing with superpositions of macroscopically distinct states, and that's the experiment of Palacios Laloy et al. In about a year ago in Nature Physics. What they actually did was to look at, to attempt to superpose, the lowest two states of a so-called Trasmon superconducting device, that is a Cooper pair box coupled to a microwave resonator. In this case, the two states which are superposed are states in which the behavior, the center of mass of a single Cooper pair is different by something like a micron. I would not myself count that as macroscopically distinct because you're only talking about one Cooper pair, but I mean, it's a matter of definition to some extent. However, I think there's a much more important, perhaps more worrying point about this paper. Everything I've said so far about these concepts of macrorealism, non-invasive measurability, et cetera, do presuppose implicitly the idea of von Neumann projective measurements. They are not doing a von Neumann measurement here. They're doing a so-called weak measurement. And what they're actually measuring is the power spectrum of the detector under conditions when you've got a continuous weak interaction between the system and the detector. Now, I think whatever else one can say, this experiment does show that under these somewhat novel conditions, the response of the detector does agree with what is predicted quantum mechanically along by Korotkov and various co-workers. The $64,000 question is, to what extent does this observation actually rule out macrorealism? And even if it was not, even if one could agree that these states were macroscopically distinct, I still don't myself see how they managed to rule out realism in this experiment. I have some difficulty here because when I try to look up the supplementary material, it turns out it's sort of full of not typos, but missing symbols and so forth, which doesn't make it particularly easy to sort out. But I just realised that, in fact, one of the group is actually here now, so I'll, Francois Nguyen. So I've only realised that very recently, but I will try to talk to him about it. My own reaction right now would be to put a large question mark here for both these reasons over that experiment until things have been sorted out a bit better. Okay, I come to the then. Any questions on that before I go on? I've finally come to the question of macrorealism and Bell. Okay, so so the question is, you raise a general question. Do the EPR-Bell experiments already exclude certain classes of macrorealistic theory, and if so, how severely? There have been very few, as far as I know, very very few discussions in the literature, precisely because the experiments have always basically assumed, I'm sorry, the discussion, the theoretical discussions have always assumed a particular solution to the measurement paradox. They've always assumed that a measurement does actually take place at an early stage along the way. And there are only very few papers which discuss what happens, or what follows or doesn't follow if you don't make that assumption. The most obvious context in which to ask the question, of course, would be in the context of the best developed macro-realistic theory, which is DRWP. Unfortunately, there's a lot of discussion by the advocates of DRWP of how to reconcile its reconcile the formalism with Lorentz invariance and so forth. Very little of the, in some sense, much more basic question of, what exactly does this say about what does the very basic considerations about Einstein locality tell us about the viability or otherwise of a macro-realistic theory? So I'm not going to talk at all about issues of Lorentz invariance and so forth. I would be quite happy to take the view which Pearl, in one of his discussions, mentions and attributes to Stapp, that there's no particular reason if we that a theory which goes beyond standard quantum mechanics, say at a sometimes much more microscopic level, should necessarily respect Lorentz invariance. It could be that there is a preferred frame, like the rest frame of the cosmos, so forth. And I would be quite happy, at least for the moment, to conduct my arguments entirely within that frame. So I'll say nothing about the question of Lorentz invariance. But, okay, let's just go back to our general setup. Remember that if you, for the moment, forget about the loopholes, including the collapse locality loophole, which I'm going to come back to, then existing experimental results appear to force us to give up at least one of three rather cherished basic principles, or cherished by many people, namely macroscopic counterfactual definiteness, induction, and Einstein locality. Now, how does that intersect with the question of macroscopic realism? Let's imagine now we've got a source which has emitted two photons back to back, and these photons have been switched by the random switches into definite detectors. So one, say, has gone into A and two has gone to B rather than B prime. Most physical collapse, PC is physical collapse here, as physical collapse theories postpone the collapse until at least until this stage, and usually to a much later stage. Okay, so we can discuss the issues under the assumption that we're talking about a particular pair of photons which has been switched into a definite pair of counters here. In fact, most of the physical collapse theories postpone the collapse until the correct quantum mechanical description. Until you've actually got a macroscopic response in your counter. You know, you've triggered a whole avalanche of electrons and so forth. Let's ask, what's the correct quantum mechanical description at that point? Well, it's very easy to work out that the photons have basically disappeared from the scene. You've got a possibility of states of counter one over here, say, which is yes. That means that the transmission counter has clicked and the reflection one hasn't, or no, the state in which the reflection counter has clicked and the transmission one hasn't, etc., etc. So this is very schematic. And for a typical zero plus transition, the correct quantum mechanical description is simply, I don't know if you read that, cosine of theta AB times this linear combination of yes, yes plus no, no, plus sine theta of AB times yes, no plus no, yes. Or rather straightforward to work that out. Notice a couple of things. At this point, really, macroscopic counterfactual definiteness doesn't really come into play because we're not trying to describe what would have happened. We're trying to describe what actually is happening in this particular experiment with this particular pair of photons. Second point is that provided we can measure, can make measurements on our devices only in the yes-no basis, which is the very, very standard situation, then the experimental predictions of that equation there are identical to those of a mixture of the four macroscopically distinct states with appropriate coefficients. Okay? Needless to say, at least in my view, that doesn't solve anything as regards the quantum measurement problem, but we should notice that that's the case. So we've now, in effect, at this point, we've already given up the prospect of seeing any interesting inference, as it were. You know, we simply have the probabilities coming up. Well, most physical collapse theories don't want to tinker with induction. I'll come back to that right at the end. And as I said, macroscopic counterfactual definiteness, at least in this particular context, seems to be irrelevant. So in effect, what they have to do is to give up Einstein locality. Now, as we've observed previously, Einstein locality is the conjunction of setting independence, or non-signaling, and outcome independence. GRWP apparently keeps So this is not really discussed, as far as I know, at least not much discussed in any of the literature by the authors thereof, but at least my conclusion would be that GRWP does keep setting independence, so it's non-signaling, but like quantum mechanics, it sacrifices outcome independence. In other words, what you've got to do is to provide a way for this linear combination to evolve into either of these two states. Where does the non-locality come in exactly? That's a bit tricky. I think, I haven't worked this through as far as I'd like, but I think essentially it comes at the point of conversion from the raw to the physical ensemble. I think that's easier to see that point in a somewhat different case where non-locality is involved, but not an EPR Bell case. So this is not EPR Bell. This is an experiment in which I've got, say, I don't know, an atom radiating through 4 pi, and it can trigger either detector 1 or detector 2. And those are going to be two different macroscopic events. So if counter 1 clicks, then counter 2 automatically doesn't, and vice versa. How does, so the quantum mechanical description at a stage where the counters have clicked is a quantum superposition of yes for 1 and no for 2 and vice versa. So crudely speaking, you can say that either there's an event here or there's an event here, or more precisely, you've got a quantum superposition of the two. Now, GRWP does convert that into one of those outcomes or the other, and the non-locality comes in the fact that the conversion from a raw to a physical ensemble involves the norm of both of these wave functions. So you do seem to have got a non-local effect there. As I say, I haven't worked this out to complete my own satisfaction, but I think that's what happens. And as I say, they don't, as far as I know, discuss this in any detail. So basically, that keeps non-signaling and sacrifices outcome independence. However, there's an alternative possibility. Let's go back to the good old collapse locality loophole. You remember that as the based on the fact that quantum mechanics itself does not tell you that a definite outcome is realized when, say, the photon passes or fails to pass a polarizer. In fact, we know it's not at that stage, basically. It doesn't even tell you that a definite outcome is realized when the photon hits the anode of the cathode, of the photomultiplier, et cetera, et cetera. So there's no definite point at which the collapse occurs. So let's exploit that to delay the collapse. We're now thinking in terms of a macro-realistic theory, so we've got to have a physical collapse coming in at some stage. Let's postpone that stage until there's time for the signal from the distant station to arrive. In other words, what we're going to be able to do, if we do that, what we're going to do is to violate the non-signaling condition, but without violating the postulate of special relativity. We're simply saying there is time for a signal to have arrived, given the known speed of light, etc. For example, in the experiment of Weiss et al., you'd have to delay the collapse to about 1.5 microseconds after the original impact of the photon, by which time, remember, the outcome has been stored in the computer and so forth. So it's pretty late in the game, in some sense, but there's no obvious reason why you shouldn't. Now, the question is, does that work? One observation is that fairly clearly, in principle at least, you could test that hypothesis in the following way. You simply have a couple of space stations. You have your two observers sitting at separations corresponding to a time difference of, let's say, a few seconds from one another. You have your incredibly powerful EPR source in between them, and you actually get each observer to not only to set his switch, but also to take the data and write it down and so forth before there is time for any signal to arrive. If under those conditions you still got the quantum mechanical results, you'd have to say that no physical collapse theory really would seem to be viable for that, but it seems a very real possibility you might not get the quantum results under that condition. However, there's actually a further difficulty, which I think is much more serious and hasn't been much, as far as I know, discussed in the literature. to introduce it, let me first make a digression by just proposing a model which obviously is not going to work. But just this is just for the sake of orientation. Let's suppose we have a very asymmetric EPR Bell experiment. Some of Anton Salinger's experiments on the Canaries, I think, have been very, very asymmetric. One of the arms has been something like 100 kilometers and the other a couple of kilometers and so forth. So they get these. Suppose that we make the postulate that that the collapse takes place at some stage as soon as one of the at least one of the two detectors has been excited to a certain stage, you know, so it's a million electrons have taken place in the cascade process or something like that, okay, or a tape has been printed out the back of the thing. Let's ask, first of all, what quantum mechanics, after gamma 1 has entered counter 1 and triggered it, but not sufficiently to cause a collapse, and gamma 2 is still on its way to gamma 2, to d2, what's the correct quantum mechanical description? If we have a standard 0 plus state and the detectors are set, the polarizers are set parallel, then it's just this state here, where y2 simply means the appropriate state of photon 2, say transverse polarization corresponding to the answer yes in counter 1, etc. So that's your quantum mechanical description. Now you're going to want to collapse this. Now, you want to collapse it at some stage before gamma 2 has got to its detector. What then is the natural assumption about the resulting state of gamma 2 following the collapse? Well, you certainly want to respect locality, so the only obvious answer is that it has to be an equal mixture of the two possible states here. But now that's clearly not going to work, because that's going to, when this guy now gets to its detector, it's going to give you a non-zero probability of yes here and no here, which is clearly in disagreement with the experiments. So that clearly is a non-starter of this. However, it's just presented to as an introduction to what I think is the real problem here. So let's try to delay the collapse until the non-signaling condition can be safely violated. So we'll say, okay, here comes photon number one. It comes into detection station number one here. It will trigger one of these counters, similarly out here. But we will not actually collapse the wave function until there's been plenty of time for a signal to arrive from, let us say, the switching event here, or even the detection event here, to the events on this side. Let's say, this actually, in absolute terms, this is not a terribly long time in any of the existing experiments. Well, unfortunately, there's a problem with this. You might think at first sight that by doing this, we could rig up a physical collapse theory which is guaranteed to give complete agreement with quantum mechanics. Okay? That's almost certainly not true. The problem is, as far as I know, I haven't seen this discussed anywhere, prior to collapse, what is the correct quantum mechanical description? At first sight, you'd say, well, it's yes 1, yes 2, plus no 1, no 2. Unfortunately, that's not true, because the process of triggering these various macroscopic devices is almost certainly going to produce unwanted effects. That is, there are going to be odd photons radiated off depending on whether it's yes or the yes counter or the no counter, which is clipped at this end. In other words, we're going to have a superposition which looks like something like this, where E1 and E prime 1 correspond to orthogonal states of the environment, let's say the radiation field, whatever. And now the real problem is that these guys don't stay around. I mean, we're mostly talking about things like radiation of photons and so forth. Photons, alas, travel off at the speed of light to infinity. So you've lost them forever. So even if there's a correlated collapse, if as it were, the system somehow manages to send a message so that that Y1 is always associated with Y2, et cetera, the environment doesn't know about that. It still has some probability to be in this state associated, which would have been associated with N1 and N2. So there's still there's a non-zero probability of getting E prime 1 and E prime 2 of your environment, despite the fact that you've got Y1 and Y2 for your actual detectors. By contrast, standard quantum mechanics would say, of course, that this probability is zero, because in some sense, by getting this result, you've collapsed the wave function to this part only, and this one automatically disappears. That's right. That's the difficulty, I think. Yeah. So unless you had really pathologically constructed device and so forth, it seems to me you can't get around this. So in other words, even if you exploit the collapsed locality loophole, it looks as if even at the present stage, no physical collapse theory, which respects locality, can give 100% agreement with quantum mechanics for all possible experiments. Now, of course, you might say, well, that's interesting but irrelevant, because after all, in real life, we never look at the states of the photons which have been radiated off. Can a theory of this type be consistent with the currently known experimental data? And I think almost certainly the answer is yes. At least so long, as I say, you don't worry about Lorentz invariants. If you start worrying about Lorentz invariants, all sorts of nasty complications come in. But if you're content to work for the sake of the argument in, say, the cosmic rest frame or whatever, and just apply your physical collapse theories in that frame, then I think yes. So there's no, to my mind at least, there's no compelling a priori reason right now to give up on macro-realistic theories. As I say, this argument does rest heavily on the observation that you can leave the physical collapse to a pretty late stage in the game and get away with it. So basically, well, that was that's where I've got to. One has to say that as of now, quantum mechanics is looking pretty good. There's a strong temptation, I think, to think it must be the ultimate and final truth about the physical world. And in some sense, I think most of you here are presumably invested in that, since it's your bread and butter. But I think one ought to at least keep an open mind for the possibility that something else is going to happen. My own, as I've hinted several times previously, my own gut feeling is that if and when something surprising in this area does happen, it will not just be concerned with the structure of quantum mechanics, it's going to be at least equally concerned with the question of the arrow of time, whether we really understand the arrow of time and the way we've applied it in interpreting all of this. Because remember that the moment that you allow, in a very trivial sense, the moment you allow information to travel back from your switch, even from your switch, let alone your detector, from your switch to your source, you have no problem in violating CHSH and everything else. So I do think myself that there's a very fundamental conceptual question sitting in there somewhere. I just wish I knew how to disentangle it. Okay, so basically that was what I wanted to say. Questions, comments, objections? Yeah.
Can you elaborate on the connection between Lorentz invariants and quantum?
Well, Lorentz invariance is a rather strict, is usually believed to be a rather strict constraint on physical theories. And in particular, if you're dealing with a physical collapse theory, say, then it should be possible, or people would like it to be possible, to specify the mechanism of the collapse itself in a way which is Lorentz invariant. And that turns out, in fact, to be really rather difficult. However, it seems to me that even if you are prepared to forego Lorentz invariance and say, well, I believe that in some future theory that is going to be a preferred rest frame, say the cosmic rest frame, and I'm going to do all my calculations in that frame, you still have, in some sense, an intuitive, immediate difficulty in, how to put it, in forcing the state over here to depend on information which is not received from, for example, the setting or the outcome over here. That's a very sort of qualitative way of putting it, but I think it's a very general constraint. So even if you throw away the requirement of Lorentz invariance. There are still substantial difficulties with these collapse theories. And it's slightly surprising to me, this hasn't been, as far as I know, as I say, much discussed by the advocates of the theory. They're always much more focused on getting Lorentz invariance straight. So Wigner's friend is a sort of elaboration of the Schrödinger's cat paradox, in which you arrange to replace the unfortunate cat by a rather trustworthy friend of yours. And of course, you don't want to kill the friend, so you just arrange that in place of the cyanide being exploded or not, he does or does not receive, say, a mild electric shock to one of his fingertips. So you get, of course, by the usual argument, apparently quantum mechanics predicts a quantum superposition of two different states of the universe, in one of which he's got the shock and in the other which he hasn't. On the other hand, when you, as it were, release him after the experiment, when you release him from the box and ask him, did you feel a shock or not, then presumably he's going to tell you either yes or no. So the question is, how do you reconcile that with the hypothesis that quantum mechanics is in principle a complete description of the physical world, including our own brains? And so on. Well, I think the answer is you can't, really. I was recently asked in a sort of questionnaire if I could get any one experiment relevant to the foundations of quantum mechanics done, irrespective of its technical difficulty, which one would you make it? And I said Wigner's friend, basically. You see, that does, if one actually could do that experiment, then the result presumably would rule out at least some classes of resolution of the measurement, or alleged solution of the measurement paradox. For example, suppose that you take the view that this is a view which some people have reasonably seriously embraced, like Wigner and so forth, in the context of this. You take the view that no realization is effected until the first conscious conscious being observes it. Okay, so until you have measurement by some kind of conscious observer, and at that point, immediately, a particular outcome is triggered. What would that imply? That would imply that in the Wigner's friend situation, since presumably your friend is a good conscious observer, one outcome or the other would be realized as soon as he feels the shock or does not. On the other hand, you see, that would then automatically obliterate the possibility of you seeing any further interference between the two states involved. And we're assuming here, of course, to make the Wigner's friend paradox meaningful in any way, you've got to assume that it's going to be possible for me outside the box to observe the interference between the two different states involved, which is a very, very extreme condition. But if you really believe that quantum mechanics is the whole truth about the whole of the physical universe, including ourselves, then presumably it should be right. So I think this so-called mentalistic solution would definitely predict that you don't see any interference under those conditions. As I say, that experiment is certainly not just centuries, but millennia away, I would think. It's far, far more difficult than the EPR Bell experiment at second-like separations. Yeah, the Oxford experiment, I think, is quite interesting because it, in some sense, might be a sort of template for what you could do at the macroscopic level. They've used this very nice technique developed here at IQC, where you sort of imprint the time correlations of your system on the actual state of your ancilla at the end of the day. Their system was the nuclear spins, the ancilla is the electron spin. And the nice thing about it was that they did the imprinting in a way which was at least arguably highly non-invasive. That is, they had basically a CNOT operation, and when you're as it were, in the non-triggering state of your system, it's arguably at least no interaction between it and the ancilla at all. So I think one can imagine doing that for a macroscopic system. I mean, there would be no need to do it. The reason they did it this way for the nuclear spins was that, so that they could actually make their final measurements on a macroscopic physical ensemble of spin, of electron spins. That's, of course, not necessary in the case of, say, squids and so forth, but it would be nice, perhaps, to do a C-naught between your system squid and maybe some other squid in a way which was at least arguably highly non-invasive. Thank you very much for your loyal attendance. I hope you've enjoyed it somewhat. Thank you.